In this episode of Supply Chain Now Radio, Matt Bean, General Manager of Kit Custom Products, discusses his perspective on triangulating education in the workforce, from the employer perspective, from the employee perspective, and from the educator perspective.
So up next today on Supply Chain Now Radio, we are welcoming Matt Bean, General Manager of a large Metro Atlanta manufacturing campus with Kit Custom Products. Good morning, Matt.
Good morning. Thank you, Scott.
So before we get started picking Matt's brain a bit, I'd like to thank him for volunteering yet again. So yesterday, Matt and I and a team of volunteers were out in Livingston Elementary in Newton County, where we were conducting Supply Chain 101 with 25 extremely sharp fifth graders.
This is your lemonade stand?
Yes, yes. Lemonade supply chain. We got to send Lee through our program. But we were talking supply chain, all things supply chain, the end-to-end supply chain with 25 fifth graders, and what an incredible experience. Right, Matt?
Yes, it was.
So key takeaways.
One, just a backdrop, but when Scott first approached me on speaking to fifth graders about supply chain, I initially was thinking, well, why aren't we talking to high school? And he highlighted that we need to get this earlier on into
upstream.
So instead of the students thinking about being a lawyer, an astronaut, an MLB player, but they think about being somebody in the supply chain industry.
That's right.
So I was excited about that. And this is the second school. I think it's your, how many schools have you been to, Scott?
That was our 19th session, sixth school, and about 435 fourth and fifth graders we have shared supply chain with.
Right. Yeah,
who's keeping track of that?
Scott's working on his own private label lemonade can actually be selling to these children.
Please, you're letting my secret out. Shared it with me.
All the kids, 98% of them like lemonade. That's right.
Scott, can you give me just a 30-second lead on what the work seminar is? And two, maybe if we have some school administrators listening or some parents with young kids, we can talk to their schools. How do they get involved in this?
Yeah, so real quick, this is part of the Apex Atlanta Skills Gap Task Force. We go into school with a team of volunteers in about 55 to 60 minutes. We talk about what is supply chain. We give examples of the automotive supply chain, the chocolate bar supply chain, the lemonade supply chain. And then we talk about some examples of careers you'll find in the supply chain, as well as some name brand companies that utilize armies of supply chain talent that are cool brands, you know, Nike and Amazon, Starbucks, brands that kids really understand and consume. So very interactive. When we kicked off this project back in November, we were like, man, it's going to take 30 or 40 minutes for these kids to understand what supply chain is. Not at all. Not even 5 minutes.
30 seconds,
really. So it's been a great experience. If folks want more information on how we can come to your school, shoot us an email at info@apexatlanta.org. But, you know, the whole program is driven by volunteers and practitioners like Matt Bean, who come out, want to spend time with the next generation and want to interact and engage and really encourage these elementary kids. So thank you for your time, Matt.
Yep. And we're looking for two things, more sessions, more schools to support.
Right.
As well as sponsors, corporate sponsors, to allow us to do this on a bigger scale.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, like if you're mentioned in their name during the thing.
That's right.
There should be some checks flowing.
Lee, I like that. We got to bring Lee out to the next one. That's terrific. And working on our private label lemonade.
Exactly.
So talking about talent development and supply chain, clearly awareness of supply chain careers and opportunities is a big piece upstream. But once they're in, Matt, kind of continuing today, one of today's themes is education and talent development. So 20 years of industry experience, leadership experience that you have, mostly in manufacturing. So what are some of the top subjects that come up front of mind when, you know, we hear about improvement, continuous improvement? What are some of those usual suspects?
Right. So I'm in the continuous improvement mind frame. You know, that's really what my team is all about. And continuous improvement comes when a problem is present. And how many times do you hear about when a problem is present that it was operator error or something to do with training, right? Whether it was an audit that you had, a safety situation, a quality escape, anything in the financial world, the medical world. If there are any errors or problems, it turns into continuous improvement. And it usually ties back to some form of education or a gap thereof.
Mm.
The other side of it is that when we get into continuous improvement inside industry, inside employers, we ask the question to engage the employees, what needs improvement? Every single time in the top 10, communication, training, engagement comes up, right? So what I'd like to talk about is our experience and some of my perspective on what's required around how you create an education strategy within your workforce.
Yep. And what I like in our pre-show warm-up conversation is we talk about the three buckets. You talk about the education, talent development from an employer standpoint, an employee standpoint, and an educator standpoint. So talking about from an employer's perspective, share some what have you seen that's effective and what are some of the things that Kit Custom Products is doing?
Sure. So as far as the employer, that's where we're going to have the most control, the most influence, be able to impact the strategy the most. The main areas that we focus around is to have a strategy around employee behaviors and culture. And then the process, that's the second area, which all companies have processes and tasks. And you have to learn how to run a piece of equipment or run a program or create a program. Back office, front office things. And then communication is the third area. And around communication, it also involves engagement. So we have a strategy internally for our employees to focus on, yes, behaviors and not just always processes, and yes, communication engagement and not just always just the process.
Now, how important is it at the very top to just choose the people you work with wisely and to have them come in with as many of these at least philosophically aligned
right.
from a culture fit that they're at least in the
So that's a great lead in to the next area of our focus is around the employee. So we have specific purposeful actions to, as much as we can, control the hiring process. And it's an opportunity. It's a whole nother conversation around, do we get it right every time? We don't. Most of the time when you're talking across the table with a prospective candidate, they're very engaged. They're very willing. They're passionate. Give examples about how they can do and will do and solve your problems, and they're the right person to get the job done. So we hire them, and we're not always right. So the key comes back to education. So as far as the employer portion of it, it's to get it right as best we can, and then to manage internally how we can move people forward to meet our goals. So this brings me to the employee's responsibility as well.
Can I stop for just a second? Because I think that's what you just shared there. What I heard is you have certain organizations that when they hire Jim or Sally or employee ABC, that person is the same person they were 5 years, 10 years later, right? But what you described there is how keeping the employee moving forward. So knowing more today than it did yesterday, knowing more this hour than it did maybe even last hour. Is that a core philosophy?
Yes.
Yeah.
Our position is not to hire to fire, right? So not everyone has the skills exactly to meet the needs we have, especially if you're evolving.
Right. So that's your assumption going in. So as long as they have the capacity to want to learn,
right,
that has to be a criteria in the hire.
That's right.
Right. Because some people don't. Some people are like...
But they'll say they do.
So that's you have to challenge. Have a way to kind of figure out if they're lying or not. Right?
Well, I believe them until I hear or see otherwise, right? So, yes. So, yeah, there's some faith in that.
Yeah. but still, that's a core belief. And a lot of companies don't share that same. I mean, they look at it as a labor cost, and they don't look at it as a huge professional development opportunity for folks that join the organization. So... So shifting gears, I didn't mean to interrupt you there, but I think that's an important distinction. So talk about talent and development from an employee standpoint. What do they need to bring to the table? What's their skin in the game?
Well, some of the employees' expectations on the and talking still about the employee, but the employer side of it is we have to be focused on our onboarding, use best practices around skills assessments, the development, progressive. Management and how we support people with their learning opportunities. So what the employee's responsibility, the piece that we look for is that they need to be teachable, coachable, willing. Right? That's the key. As long as somebody's willing, then we can work with them. They have to be intentional about what they want. Engage, participative, speak up, and ultimately to have some tolerance for that. For people to learn and not have the answers every time. Mm. And kind of going back to the the concept that you brought up about the forever issue of two different cultures clashing, right? So we need employees that can bring some professionalism and tolerance for learning together.
Now, what about like resilience and the capacity to take risks and yes. be okay with things not working out or changing gears that, you know, you might have invested a lot of the time in one area, but
right.
as we talked about earlier, things change dramatically in short periods of time. So yesterday's process may not be tomorrow's process.
Right. So two sides to that, the employer to create a culture that will accept some level of risk as long as some level of processes are followed from the employee. The employee side is to have some open-mindedness and to be able to evolve, right? So that gets back to the willingness piece. As long as they're willing to grow and the employer is willing to work with them, there's a partnership.
Mm.
If that willingness fades, then usually people will end up moving on or some other decision is made.
So there's an equal yoke there. Yeah. Right. Okay. All right.
So the last area that we really are focused on is the educators. So as far as the educators, there's minimal control over that. You know, we have the focus internal and we have the focus external. And the internal side, it's around like who teaches, right? Who is going to be, you know, if you have willing employees to learn, to grow, and to support your business, who is going to teach them within your organization? That's a whole nother conversation as well, is about how do we teach? And I'm learning every day still how to interact and engage with employees to help various people from varied backgrounds and how to learn and how to engage. So who is teaching? You know, we have there's people that are natural talent. Mm-hmm. You know, we can say, oh, that employee is awesome. They're great. They get it. We can tell them one thing and they take off and they evolve. No, is that real teaching or is that individual, right? So then really the ultimate focus is around our leaders and managers, that we look for them to on the continuum to be the teacher, the coach, and then the mentor, right? So depending on
the manager.
And the manager to manage the issues, right? We have SMEs or subject matter experts that will develop and grow. Sometimes we bring consultants in and then
like professional trainers to train some specific things.
We need more of that, right? Mm-hmm. So if it's the consultant, we would put in quotes that we would assume that they're a professional trainer, but that's also varied as well as how they come in and engage with the employees. So we'll work through different areas on that. And then we'll send people out to seminars, right? So you get those ad hoc teachings that are 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, right? The external side is an interesting situation that we're seeing and we're starting to really get our hands around what this means. And it kind of ties into the educators, right? As far as what before they come to us. So, you know, formative years are at home. The parents are the teachers, right? As we move into our 6 to 12-year-old range, that elementary school, you know, 12 to 18, you're in high school and middle school, high school. And then from that point, that 18-year-old.
Yeah, they know everything. So you don't have to worry about that person, right?
So now what's the path? Which way do they go? And what a lot of these folks will go right into business, right into corporations. So the educators of the 18-year-olds are the employers. And it goes right back to, at that point, there's a heavy focus around behaviors. Again, the processes will still be there. And then how people communicate and engage, right? Mm-hmm. So that gets us back to that strategy that we have to have some purposeful actions around all three of those areas. So 18-year-olds need a lot more focus around
right.
how to work within an environment that requires teamwork, mm-hmm. right? And then the you know, some folks will go into associate's degrees. They'll go, hopefully, we continue to see some support around trade schools. We're seeing a little bit more.
Right, like a certificate rather than a college degree.
Right, right.
Or professional certification.
Right. Professional certifications, whether it's, you know, the trades that we need, right? And then there are people that obviously will go on to college and universities and progress into masters and PhDs and get very specialized, right? So the point here is that if we step back and think about it, 18-year-olds to 26-year-olds are entering the workforce. And then they spend 40 to 50 years in the workforce. Who's educating them? The companies. So I'm one of those companies and I'm recognizing that, hey, we have to have a good strategy around this. And then from how we interact with the trade schools, with the consultants of the world, with the APICs of the world, the Georgia Techs of the world, mm-hmm. how we interact and partner with them will help us progress.
Now, are you partnering with them in the sense that they're developing kind of curricula that is specific to what you need so that at the end of the day, they're kind of producing?
Well, yeah, I'm going to bring you on. You're going to come back to work with me today. We are actively working with one of the trade schools that's close to us to do exactly that. Their whole lives are teaching, right? They have a passion for teaching. So the curriculum, how you develop it, how you connect to people, how you put I call it the Lego communication, right? So there aren't any words, and somehow, some way through pictures, we create Legos, or our children do, right? And they create these massive things that
I still sometimes.
There's no words, right?
My son Ben sucks me in. So
yeah. Yes. So I often ponder and I wonder, and I actually am continuing to look for these opportunities of where are the teachers? So we have all these teachers, and there's all kinds of conversations around how they're compensated, how they're valued, how they're respected. And they go through a lot from 0 to 18 to 26 years. But how about the teachers getting into industry, right? Mm-hmm. And what if one teacher was in every single corporation, right?
Like online learning and things like that, where it's kind of at the pace of the student in their own environment. Are you implementing any of that?
We see that this is the issue is of to create that with CBTs, computer-based training. When you're a larger organization, you have the opportunities or the resources to create that internally. There are opportunities I need to dig into myself. I'm sure there's software and programs out there.
But like there's like some of the universities have these MOOCs, the massive online courses where they're
like a Coursera or something like that.
Where they're out there and they have learning sometimes free mm-hmm. on different areas that are relevant. Is that trickled into the supply chain world?
Most definitely.
We personally have not pursued that other than we've seen with the trade schools that we're partnering with, a mix of that. So there's in person, on site, and also some form of online. So there is a mix of that we're seeing through this partnership we're working on.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm definitely open to learning more about opportunities there.
Yeah, I think it comes down to preference and what works for different companies, right? I think with online training, you've got that challenge of engagement. These very common sense challenges, right? Whether it's a webinar, whether it's a Skype type session, engagement and really making sure you're bringing it home and folks are actively listening and contributing. And these are critical hallmarks of successful training programs. So it kind of just depends on what works for the organization, right?
It's a great area to pursue because the time is always the issue, right? Mm-hmm. The 40 hours or that you're paying somebody to break them out and carve out time to say, oh, you're going to sit down for 4 hours a week or 8 hours a week to learn something. So if you have online opportunities, the learning can happen outside of the workday.
Yep. Then this is a great aspect of the conversation to segue into the next segment. Matt and John, we could sit down with y'all for hours and pick your brain. I appreciate what you've shared. I like your perspective. I mean, I think you and the culture that you describe at Custom Products, it's appealing to work there. You know, it's appealing the culture, the empowerment, development opportunities, how when you step foot in there day one and day 10, day 1,000, you're going to be an advanced person. You're going to pick up new skill sets, new responsibilities. So I think that's appealing in this war for talent that we all see and feel every day, right?
We try, right?
Yeah.
In our mission, we have the words, creating a learning culture and a continuous improvement culture.
Love it. Well, thanks for spending time with us today on Supply Chain Now Radio, Matt. And thanks again for it's not just lip service. Matt's out there, engaging with the next generation and planting these seeds of awareness for opportunity. So appreciate all your support and leadership.
Yeah. Like what's the website if somebody wants to learn more?
So as far as our company?
Yeah.
It would be KIKCustomProducts.com.
Perfect. All right, Matt, thanks. Appreciate it.